Hello and welcome to the programme. I'm joined today by Daniel Harris, who's a local activist. And I'm going to start by thank you for joining us, Daniel. I want to start by asking what's been in the news in the past week. But it's the inauguration of Donald Trump as the 45th president of the United States. Yeah. How do you feel about that?
It's a very strange time at the moment in politics. As a LGBT sort of activist, I'm quite worried about some of the comments that he's made. Specifically around sort of equalities.
Yeah.
He's been very vocal about, you know, Muslims, and he has mentioned potentially repelling some of the LGBT legislation in America. So that's quite alarming. However, I wasn't really that sort of blown over by Hillary Clinton either. So we'll see. We'll see. It's going to be an interesting 4 years, isn't it?
I think it's going to be fascinating in some respects. If the world's still here at the end of 4 years or whatever.
Don't. He's got access to that red button. I don't know.
Frightening. Don't tweet too late at night, Donald. Okay, that's enough of that, I think. Locally, what's been happening? Were you out and about? I'm sure you were out and about on Saturday, weren't you?
I was, yeah.
What was happening on Saturday?
Saturday was the NHS demonstration, massive, really, really big demonstration that happened throughout the city. Started at the hospital, and John McDonnell, the Shadow Chancellor, came down to Brighton. I was at a stall at Churchill Square at the clock tower, and we were collecting signatures, really. We're really concerned about, you know, the state of the NHS at the moment. I don't know if any of your residents saw, but recently in a newspaper, there was that picture of that two-year-old sort of baby that was in the hallways of the hospital on two chairs. And, you know, it's just so concerning. But what really sort of, you know, amazed me was the turnout on the day. And I did a video, actually, and it did go viral.
I've seen it.
And some of the responses from people across the country, you know, the solidarity. And I really think if people band together, you know, across the country, you know, we can get these potential cuts reversed. But, you know, they promised us £350 million, didn't they? They were talking about that
if we leave the European Union.
Yeah. You know, they promised that, and nothing's ever come, you know, nothing's come of that. So,
Did you believe that promise?
No, but still, that's something that they said. And I think we have to, with politicians, you know, like you spoke about Trump before, when they say things, we have to hold them to account. You know, there's too much lying at the moment.
I just wonder with that 350 million thing, and I might have got this wrong, that they were saying that. That some were saying, we spend £350 million a day because of our membership of the European Union, therefore if we leave, this money will be free to spend on other things like the NHS. Not that we will spend it on the NHS, but...
People care about the National Health Service.
Absolutely. I mean, you know? I suspect a lot of people just pick up a few things from that message, which is why people are saying, where's that 350 for the NHS? And it's not happening.
But it's also quite interesting as well, because, you know, we're very lucky. We have the National Health Service. We have that. And potentially, you've got Donald Trump talking about getting rid of Obamacare in America. So let's not go down the route of America. Let's stick with what we've got because it's a good system.
And make it better. Well, I think the former Conservative Chancellor, Nigel Lawson, I think it was, described NHS as our national religion.
Yeah.
In both the governing parties in recent years, the Labour and the Conservatives have been criticised for fragmenting or privatising bits of it or outsourcing parts of it. So, you know, there's always the sort of characterisation that the Conservatives are more up for this than Labour, but facing the financial pressures, they've both tried to look at ways they can get more bang for their buck, if you like. And health inflation goes up faster than general inflation.
Yeah.
You know, rather like house prices seem to rise faster than wages, in my experience.
But if you look in real terms over a period, we're really not. There is a cut in, you know, the money that is coming forward to the actual NHS. But there are lots of issues. There's lots of privatisation within the NHS. You've got these big pharmaceutical companies which are, you know, charging astronomical amounts for, you know, for medicines and stuff. And that is you know, some of the money that's coming from the NHS. So I mean, I personally would love to see, you know, us have a sort of a national pharmaceutical company, you know, that would be perfect. We could produce our own medicines, it'd be so much cheaper. So there are lots of ways that they can make the service better, but...
I mean, on the basis they're not here to defend themselves, I think what Big Pharma would probably say is we try lots and lots of different things and it costs a lot of money, so that when we do get a breakthrough drug, one that's successful, we charge so much while it's protected by patent is to, well, so we can invest more for future.
Do you remember that last year there was, I think it was last year, there was that hedge fund manager or somebody in America brought the rights to a HIV drug and, you know, and increased the price by about 3,000% or something. Now that is disgusting. And that's what I'm saying, yeah. You know, that people have that power.
Yes. Yeah, I'm sure that kind of thing in itself, where somebody, you know, if, from the finance world is exploiting, it's very different. But the pharmaceutical stuff, particularly the startup companies, the ones that have grown into the bigger companies today, would argue we charge a lot so we can reinvest it in trying to come up with new drugs, new solutions.
Yeah.
I know there's strong critiques of that model as well.
We've got PrEP as well, so that's the antiviral drug, which it's just been absolutely amazing in trials, and I know many people that take that actually. So when, when they have an experience, sexual experience with somebody else, you know, if they do have HIV and they're undetectable, which means the amount of the virus is very low in the system, you know, it's practically impossible to you know, to catch HIV. So the fact that the NHS is now looking to adopt that that plan for the medication and to be able to provide that to people, I praise that.
It's
sort of
spent to save in a way, because it's if you can prevent, it's cheaper to prevent than to cure. Simon Dow from the Beacon mentioned this when we were speaking only a couple of weeks ago on the vote, and I wondered. I mean, one of the things that's come up, you know, part of the reason we were speaking to Simon is because there's a lot of concern about the future of the Beacon at the moment and how that might survive.
Yeah.
Is this something that's crossed your radar?
It has. I know many people actually that have used the services of the Beacon. I remember there's a particular person that I know. He's in a wheelchair, housebound, and quite hard for his personal carers. Quite a difficult person to look after, and from a carer's perspective, you know, they need a break themselves. So you know, that person goes to the Beacon. He has his respite. And it gives a break for the carers. Now, if that service is gone, where does that, you know, where does the service user go? And where do the carers, how do they get their respite? And not just that, you know, the Sussex Beacon has been a beacon in Sussex for, you know, for many years now. And, you know, and whilst I understand the drugs are getting better and the services are getting better, I do know that many LGBT people that suffer homelessness, they also use the Beacon because they have those rooms, and you know, and they do get to go there, and it's that safe environment of, you know, of so many activities. You meet other people. Yeah. There's the, you know, there's the community aspect there, and I'm just really concerned.
I think a lot of people are. I mean, it's interesting as well. It's one of the very few places locally in the health world that's got outstanding ratings for care by the Care Quality Commission, the CQC. So the money that's being spent there, and it's not NHS funded. I mean, they do have some contracts from the NHS, and the value of those contracts is shrinking. The NHS says, hey, we don't want to spend as much with you, and this is, I think, the source, a big source of the problem. But the Beacon fundraises loads for itself. I mean, I confess I'm not going on the Beacon Half Marathon next month.
Me
I
too.
Don't think I could run that far at the moment. But, I mean, hopefully what we can do, I guess, is support the people we do know who are running to raise money for the Beacon at what is a very difficult time. And I think they're now sitting there asking themselves some very hard questions about, if we don't get the money we need from the NHS, what can we provide? What can we provide sustainably, and what do we have to stop providing? But ideally, I guess, they're hoping they'll persuade the NHS locally. And there's a huge petition going
They're absolutely.
And over 10,000 signatures already.
Yeah, and it'll keep growing. But ultimately, you know, every summer we have Pride. This year it's been announced the Summer of Love, so it's going to be a fantastic theme. But I'm hoping, you know, if you go back to, you know, Gay Pride, it's been very much set up around protest.
Yeah.
Now, I want LGBT people and, you know, and folk, and other folk in the city, I want them on Pride this year to come out and march to support the Beacon.
Oh, I'm sure people will. I mean, it's funny how it's gone from being a protest when it started to becoming increasingly a celebration, particularly in Brighton. And I think, it'd be interesting to see, actually, what the state of play is with the Beacon by the time Pride takes place this year and what the call is. Because I suspect even if they get contracts sorted out this year, it'll be for a year or two or three years.
Yeah, absolutely.
They've still got some hard things.
But we have the chance this year. We have the chance, and I really think we should make the most of Pride and do the protest.
Listen, I wanted to ask you about some of the other local organisations that are very helpful as well. We're going to take a break for ads in a minute, but if I could just start you, and I might stop you, talking about All Sorts. So First of all, you've used their services, I think.
I was a service user, yes, about 10 years ago.
Okay, and again, I mean, they've been the Mayor's charity more than once. They're one of the Mayor's charities more than once. Just, I mean, just very briefly, what's the essence of what they provide?
It's a safe space for LGBT people in the city and outside the city. Actually, they've got many people that come from outside the city, but we'll talk more.
Okay, I mean, what? Again, very, very briefly, what did they provide for you, in essence? Was it health or welfare? I'll tell you what, I'm going to ask this after break, so we're going to take a short break for these ads. Keep that question in your head, don't go away. And join us again after these adverts. Thanks. Welcome back to the programme. I'm joined by Daniel Harris, a local LGBT campaigner, and I would say housing campaigner as well, but maybe we'll come on to that in a minute, Daniel. Just let me start. I was trying to ask you before the break about All Sorts, and desperately trying to juggle the time there badly. Tell me about All Sorts. What did they do for you?
I remember I ended a relationship, my first relationship. I come out at the age of 16, and I moved away, actually. I left the city. So as you can imagine, when you've finished the relationship and you come back to the city, I didn't have any friends. I didn't know anybody. I left a straight person and come back gay, you know. And I remember somebody told me about All Sorts, and I was a bit hesitant, as you are. I went along, and it was just fantastic. It was, you know, a group of like-minded people, LGBT people, a safe space. And you have to go back, you know, this was about 15, 16 years ago. So back then, you know, attitudes were slightly different.
Yes.
You know, there was a lot more sort of homophobia in the city. So it just provided me with a place that was, you know, you've got to do workshops, you can, you know, you've got internet there, access, I was shocked when I went, I was shocked at the number of people under the age of 16 that were using the services. You know, people just don't understand, and there is a lot of stigma sort of attached to mental health. Okay, and whilst they don't advertise themselves as a mental health service, people do need to understand that many of the people that are accessing their services may not have come from the open and relaxed environment of Brighton and Hove. They may have come from outside the city, and to come in, it's really given them, you know, a lot of education, and it's really they help them with the mental health as well.
I think the support that a lot of us take for granted, perhaps from our friendship circles or that kind of thing.
My concern is the under 16 service. I think they've got when I went about 10 years ago or whatever, there was about 3 or 4 people under the age of 16. They've got 130 something people now, but that's not statutory funding. So if they lose any funding, then those kids are the ones that lose out, and that's our next generation.
So when we see things like the Mayor, I mean, I was thinking of the Mayor's charity, because the Mayor's charity every year, and it's never just one, it's always at least 2 or 3, and this year I think Pete West, the Mayor's supporting in a sort of in a wider way, a couple of dozen charities.
And actually, I remember last year, I think it was, or 2015, Labour.
Yeah.
They announced this LGBT policy, and it was done at All Sorts. And it was Peter Kyle and a few other people that come down. So I would hope that All Sorts wouldn't get cut, you know, especially when they launched the LGBT manifesto there. But we'll see.
It's very difficult. I mean, we're seeing at the moment with protests over the youth service cuts, and these are actually contracts placed with public with voluntary organisations by the council to provide services, and it's very difficult. The council is in a very difficult position financially,
of course,
compared with the past. Equally, this is not a popular proposal, I don't think, across the youth services, and indeed
with 80% cuts.
It's a huge change.
And you were at the Housing and New Homes Committee last week, and I absolutely have to praise the youth that got up and asked those questions. Yeah. And one of the questions that I was really amazed at was, you know, they were talking about the executives in the council.
Yes.
and how some of the executives are earning more than Theresa May, the Prime Minister. And the youth said, you know, why can't they take a 30% cut and that'll pay for most of the cuts that we're proposing? I think that's a brilliant idea.
Well, the Policy and Resources Committee, it's a very hard, it's always a challenging one. I mean, I hesitate to get, in the short time we have for this programme, into the merits of executive pay. Mm.
But there is a protest, Frank.
Yeah.
This Saturday 28th, it starts at 1 o'clock. Everyone in the city, similar to the NHS one, starts at the Old Steen and it's going to be going around the city and really making a big thing.
And I think we'll hear more from those people as the council tax budget gets closer to being set at the end of February. Mm. So, and indeed, I mean, the one thing at Policy and Resources last week, Warren Morgan, the council leader, who chairs the Policy and Resources Committee, offered to take four young people with him and Peter Carr MP up to 10 Downing Street.
I thought that was brilliant. Really good.
Whether it'll make any substantial difference, I suspect not, but it's engaging.
It's engaging new people, and that's what we want, and I have to praise Warren, for actually taking those steps.
I guess it's a way of raising the profile of this issue and the hard choices that are having to be made. I mean, we had the Housing Committee meet last week. I know you've campaigned long and hard on the quality of emergency accommodation, particularly in the city, and also the way that the housing department deals with emergency and temporary tenants. They announced last week building some sort of purpose-built flats, if you like, in Oxford Street, for example, elsewhere. Heartened by that?
I'm very happy. I won't say who, but I do talk to councillors. I had a few meetings last week, and when we sat down and we spoke, you know, it is a testament of the pressure that not just me, but other activists as well, are putting to get the council to change the way that they think about housing in the city. We know about 64% of the housing in this city is privately owned.
Yes.
So, you know, and as the social housing in the city is just going down and down and down, whilst, you know, I think Anne was on yesterday or this week.
Anne Meadows, who chairs the Housing Committee, has been on the vote this week. Yes.
Brilliant. Yes. So she's talking about, I think, 300 units that they've built. Excellent. But under the right to buy, you know, legislation, we're also losing properties.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's 12 units, temporary accommodation, and, you know, it is going to be, you know, a model. If they adopt that model and they go forward, essentially, you know, what they're going to do is the income that they get, it's going to be, the council will be then able to build more council housing in the city. So if they continue with this process and take all of the current temporary and emergency accommodation out of the private hands, we know that 20 million is currently being spent, you know, from housing benefit to pay for these. So what we really want them to do...
20 million, that's a huge sum.
That's a year
as
well.
On emergency and temporary housing.
Yeah.
I mean, why is it so high? Is it because we've got a lot of people who need that support, or is it because it's a more expensive type of housing? Because
I don't know why.
It's often called on at short notice, isn't it? So presumably the council will pay over the odds. Because
it's a nightly licence if you're in emergency accommodation, so you're looking at about £28 to £30 a night. I think you can actually stay in the one of the hotels in the city for a similar price. So it is literally like staying in a hotel, but
without the luxury.
There's no luxury, absolutely none. However, you know, things are improving. They are doing more inspections, and a lot of the inspections that they do now, they have to be reported back to committees, which has never happened before. So it'll be really interesting to see the standards and how they are rising. But that's why I set up EFREG, which is the UK's first residents association, and it's exclusive for residents that live in emergency and temporary accommodation.
So EFREG stands for Emergency Temporary Housing
Residents Action Group. So, you know, we've had a massive decline in residents associations in the city.
Yeah.
We used to have hundreds. Now we don't. And what you're starting to see now is the fight back of residents. You know, we're fed up. Absolutely fed up with money coming, you know, money from the, you know, the system going straight back out. And let's be clear, you know, we are doing investigations, and there is, you know, there is some shady stuff going on in relation to, you know, tax and stuff and how that's being done. But that will come out.
So some of
the
private landlords are registered offshore. I mean, I think we saw with the Panama Papers there were suggestions that in this country there are private landlords here.
Yeah. Well, we have to be asking questions, and
that can be done legitimately, I should say. But,
of course. But you think if you're a business and you're working with public sector, you know, you would expect them to kind of pay UK tax and pay a good rate. You know, they're making £20 million a year. And that's just in this area, and we've got about 5,000 people in emergency and temporary accommodation in the city.
Well, that's a hell of a lot. And, I mean, in terms of what happens, I mean, you know, I know you've highlighted some individual cases as well, and I think you won't mind us mentioning his case, but Bobby Carver locally is a paraplegic who's got a terribly difficult situation. He can't get up and down. He's in a first or second floor flat.
He's in an attic flat, yeah.
Yeah, and I think it's fair to say his condition has deteriorated since he's been there. But trying to find somewhere suitable is challenging.
We keep selling them.
But that's not the council's choice, is it?
The council's choice. Absolutely, it's not the council's choice. And I fully understand that. Of course I understand that. However, we have a responsibility to ensure that people with disabilities also have a home which is accessible.
Yeah.
Now, this is legislation. So, Bobby, my heart just goes out to Bobby. It really does. And I'm telling you now, we must get this sorted. And we must be building more houses which are accessible for the disabled.
Yeah.
We've got to
I've noticed it's under this administration, the Labour administration, under the Green administration before, Bill Randall was particularly vocal about this. And Mary Mears previously, a Conservative. So you've got people across all three parties representing the council who feel very strongly we need to provide more wheelchair accessible homes, more homes that are accessible for people with other disabilities that perhaps sometimes less visible disabilities too.
But that's a testament to the city that we have the union now in around housing. We do have that, so that is a testament to the city.
I know there's a lot of argument over the details sometimes, but the broad consensus is moving that way.
Yeah.
What next? So there's a protest next, Hattie, about the youth service.
I've been working. Most of the stuff I've been doing is with EFRAG. We're going to be at the Fringe this year, so that's a massive step forward. We're working with the Forum Theatre. It's going to be amazing. We're going to be telling stories in a drama type way, and it's going to really evoke emotion. People are going to find out exactly what it's like to live in emergency and temporary accommodation in the city.
Well, that will be interesting. I look forward to that. Good luck with that. Daniel, thank you very much for joining us, and I hope you'll join us again soon.
I will.
And all the best for now. Please do join us again on the LGBT vote very soon. Thanks for watching. Goodbye for now.